Father, maybe four times, a couple feet each time. And I don't know about you, but it's a pleasure to be with you. Also, big game today. I know most of us have our minds on the game with the Chiefs this afternoon. Just so you know, I have a wager going with the district president in Missouri. And if the Bills win, he's got to give me a case of Kansas City barbecue. And if not, if for some reason it won't happen, but if the Chiefs were to win, then I have to send him at his district office a case of Anger Bar Buffalo Wing Sauce. So that's the wager that's on for this afternoon. Adds a little interest to the game for me. So, we'll engage our order of service this morning and we begin with a prayer. We have a prayer for the for future past dependency.
Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings you have given to Salem congregation these many years. We ask now with humble hearts for your direction in the selection of a leader for Salem. Help us to be patient with hope in our hearts, trusting totally in you, because you have promised to serve us. We ask this in faith that you have already chosen the new shepherd. We thank you and trust in your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
servants of the Lord.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore.
And the rising of the sun to the setting, the name of the Lord is to be praised.
Gracious Lord, by your name you have called us your own, and we are to pray, praise, and give thanks to you.
Steadfast love toward us.
seventh chapter. This is what I mean, brothers. The appointed time has grown very short. From now on, let those who have wives live as though they had none, and those who mourn as though they were not mourning, and those who rejoice as though they were not rejoicing, and those who buy as though they had no goods, and those who deal with the world as though they had no dealings with it. For the present form of this world is passing away. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the following. text is the Old Testament reading from the book of Jonah chapter 3. This is one of the few times in the church year, one of the few times actually in the entire cycle of the lectionary that the book of Jonah occurs. We have a 3-year cycle, so you're only hearing the book of Jonah once every 3 years. And yet, even though it hardly ever comes up, you all know the story. You all know the story of Jonah. It's probably one of the best known, most familiar stories in the church and in the world. And that's because it's almost universally known as a story for kids. If you've ever taught Sunday school, and the lesson for the day is Jonah, you thank the lucky stars. You think, oh, I got an easy lesson today. Because kids love the story of Jonah. And you usually have them sitting there, you know, with a collar, with a patient collar. There's Jonah, and there's always that great big fish that swallowed him. Kids love it. It's an easy story to tell. It captures the imagination of children. But the story of Jonah is not a kid's story. It is not intended for children. It's intended for adults. And it's a very adult story if you read the thing through. But the first thing I need to do is review the story, which isn't hard, because the entire book of Jonah is 4 chapters long. So it doesn't take long to recount everything that happened. In a nutshell, Jonah is a prophet. Now, what's a prophet? And a lot of people will say, well, a prophet is somebody who can see the future. My answer to that is not necessarily. A prophet in the scriptures is simply one who speaks the word of God. He speaks the word of the Lord to the people, and sometimes it has to do with the past, sometimes it has to do with the present, and sometimes it has to do with the future. But a prophet is one chosen by God to deliver his word to people. Is a person spoken, chosen to speak God's word. So Jonah is already a prophet. He's already been chosen by God for this purpose. And in verse 1 and 2 of chapter 1, it says, the word of the Lord came to the son of Amittai, go to the city of Nineveh and preach against it. And what God wants Jonah to do is to go to the city of Nineveh, a notoriously wicked and sinful city, and call the people to repent. You know, tell them to turn back to God, turn to the true God, and give up your evil ways. That's what God tells Jonah to do, and he doesn't think it's a particularly good idea. For a number of reasons. Number one, the city wasn't populated by Jews, it was populated by pagans. It was populated by heathens. The city of Nineveh was populated by mean, nasty people. They were basically scared Syrians. The Syrians were not nice people. When they would invade a city, they'd chop off your ear and your hands just for the fun of it. They burned people at the stake and sat there and laughed, but it was a great time. These are wicked people. These are not the kind of people you want to be around. They poke at your eyes and think it's a great thing. So it's understandable that, first of all, for that, just for that reason, Jonah doesn't want to know. He doesn't relish the idea of going to the Ninevites on a personal level. And he also questions God's reason. Why would God want to save them? Why would God want to save these irredeemably evil for these and probably a whole some other reasons. God says, I want you to go to Nineveh. And he goes the opposite direction. Travels out of Java to the coast. Jumps on a boat headed for Tarshish, which is clear on the other side of the Mediterranean. Nineveh is this way, he goes out. West coast of Spain is where he's headed. He goes in the opposite direction from where God wants him to go. Well, they get underway. God sends a storm. Violent waves are crashing over the boat. The wind is howling. The sailors were afraid. These weren't guys on Lake Erie in a charred fishing boat. These were seasoned sailors. And if you have seasoned sailors who are afraid, you got a problem. They become afraid. You know it's bad. And they knew a couple of things. They said to themselves, you know what, this isn't the time of year we get storms. This isn't the time of year we get these kind of storms. The other thing they noticed is they had never seen a storm so fierce. So they quickly figured out somebody is on this boat that is upset by their God. They do the logical thing. They cast lots to see who it is. Guess who it lands on? Jonah. Jonah is the guilty part. And we're all very familiar with what happens next. Jonah's tossed overboard. He gets swallowed by a great big fish. And he spends 3 days in the belly of the fish, which had to be pretty stinky. State of affairs. His feet are tangled up in seaweed. And from inside the belly of that fish, he prays to God. A beautiful prayer. In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From the depths of the grave, I called for help, and you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the deep, into the heart of the seas. The currents swirled around me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I was banished from your sight. The engulfing waters frightened me. The deep surrounded me, seaweed wrapped around my head. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, O Lord. My prayer rose to you. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs, but with a song of thanksgiving will sacrifice to you. Salvation comes from the Lord. God hears the prayer. The fish vomits him up on shore. God says to Jonah, get going. Nineveh. Apparently he's got the message. Off he goes. When he gets there, he preaches one of the shortest sermons in the history of the world. He says to them, 40 days and Nineveh will be overturned. In other words, it's going to be destroyed. Wipe off the map. And the amazing thing is, it worked. It says that the entire city believed him, or as we should say, believed God. The people started fasting. The people put on sackcloth. King sends out a royal decree that everybody is to fast and put on sackcloth, a sign of repentance, and even the animals are to put on sackcloth. Imagine dressing up your dog or cat in sackcloth. Sign of repentance. And most importantly, everybody was to give up their sinful ways, turn to the true and living God. I think several reasons. I think, first of all, I think the story is going to challenge us personally. Am I willing to go where God leads me? Am I willing to go where God wants me to go? Even if it's outside my comfort zone, am I willing to go there? Is God calling me to do something? Is God trying to get my attention and I'm refusing to hear? Or perhaps I'm even going in the opposite direction. Am I open to God's call? I've told you the story many times, and I'm going to tell it to you once again. I was never going to go to Buffalo. I swore up and down, if there's one place on the face of earth I would never live, it was Buffalo, New York. And the other pastors remind me of that often. And I used to always come up here in January. We would have our conference at Christ the King Seminary, and I would always be blinded by snow. It would be snowing so hard I couldn't even see my briefcase, and I would say, who could live here? Guess what? It's about 15 years ago, isn't it? I never, ever, in a million years, thought I would be elected district president. I would have told you you're nuts. It's never that. Guess what? God had other plans. He has a way of working things out, doesn't he? Secondly, I think this story calls us to do some introspection. I think it calls us to look inside ourselves. Who deserves to be saved? Who deserves to be saved? And I bet every one of us in this room can come up with a list of people who we don't think deserve. The problem is God desires all people to come to a knowledge of the truth and be saved. That's what the scripture says. Even the people that I particularly like. And when I get to thinking thoughts like that, I need to remind myself that I didn't deserve salvation. I didn't deserve to be saved. I didn't deserve God's grace and mercy. Sinner that I am. But God had mercy on me. He showered me with his grace. And now he calls each one of us to do is extend that grace and mercy to others in Jesus' name. If God wants to save this person over here, but I don't think it would like, who am I to stand for? Mission and ministry in a city. And a lot of times now when we think of cities, we think of old and crumbling buildings, and we think of crime, and we think of potholes and poverty. And it bothers me that our church body, and just about every other church body, has abandoned our cities. There used to be 30 Lutheran churches in the city of Buffalo. Did you know that? 30. We're one of the last standing. We have in our district, the city of Syracuse, New York. We do not have a single Eastern District congregation here. Did you know that? Not one. You think, how's that possible? In fact, sin. We have no presence. Well, the answer is we've abandoned the city. We're very good at building churches in the suburbs. We abandon cities. fine if you're going to do that, at least support the mission in the city. At least support mission work in the cities. Because our job is to seek and save the lost. And yet, most important of all, the book of Jonah points us to Jesus Christ. The book of Jonah points us to his death and resurrection for our salvation. And you know how I know that? Because in the New Testament, Jesus himself refers to Jonah. He's speaking to the Pharisees. They say that they accuse him of doing miracles by way of Satan. And they say, Jesus, give us a sign from God. And he says to them, quote, "A wicked and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but none will be given except the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and nights in the belly of the fish, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." And Jesus, of course, is referring to his impending death on the cross for our sakes. His body placed in a tomb. His resurrection from the dead for the salvation of us all. And so, this most important purpose on the earth is all the rest. Jesus, or Jonah, prays for salvation from way down deep. And we, every single one of us, was way down deep in our sin. But God had heard our prayer. And he sent his Son, Jesus Christ, to die and rise again for us. And now charged with calling people to repent and faith in Jesus, God's Son. Crucified, buried, risen, of whom Jonah is a sign.
Lord, in your
who read that the assured promise of Christ's victory over death and the grave brings hope in times of hopelessness. For those who live in doubt, fear, and distress, extend your call of grace through your word, and those who proclaim it. Father, we also pray, praise and thank you for good news, for joyful events in our lives. We give thanks for the birth of a great grandchild to the glory of all. We ask that you give Noah and Elliot and parents, son, with love, give them great joy as they bring this child up with the knowledge of his son. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we praise your name. You gave Jesus Christ his love for us and tell him to go to the cross and be saved by faith. Unite us with him in our fellowship together. And in repentance, we faithfully receive the gifts of life and grace that he gives to us through his body and blood. Help us to draw our strength, love, compassion, and mercy through you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Lord, bless our country and our people. Give your special aid to the President, members of Congress, our governor and state representatives, our mayor and others who hold office in our nation and community. Give them faith and wisdom that relying on you and seeking to do your will, they may enact wise laws and administer them justly, so that the welfare of our people be assured and peace maintained at home and abroad. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. We worship God with our life.
Please stand. We join.